Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. Today, we're going to talk about the latest benefits of a vegetarian diet and how it's spreading throughout the world. More and more people are trying the healthy benefits from eating a plant-based diet. Also, what is the role of loneliness and your heart? Copenhagen University Hospital has some stuff on that. We have a lot more. Of course, always state-of-the-art health, always based upon evidence-based medicine, and always ahead of the curve. But today I have no guest because I wanted more commentaries. I wanted you to have an opportunity to speak back on these topics. We don't screen our calls. So whoever has something to say relevant to the topic is always invited on. And by and large, the vast majority of our callers offer their own input on an idea, and it's almost always good, something we can go forward from there. So you're going to have a lot of opportunity today because I'm going to, first up in about 15 minutes, I'm going to have you listen to an ex-Marine in a debate. He's debating about why we got into the war in Syria. It's not a long debate. He's debating with a top policy wonk from the State Department in Washington, D.C. Why is this important? Because you will not hear this debate on any American television. I think this was either Al Jazeera or RT. Then he's going to tell us what he says is the truth. This is the kind of message you need to hear. Do you remember the movie Paderewski's Network? Some of the most brilliant and articulated wordsmith I've ever heard of any film was in Network. In fact, I'm going to ask Jesse to find a clip from Network. Remember where the guy says, you know, we've got to get angry, we've got to get mad. But if you go back and watch it, I don't care how many times you watch it, you get these little gems of insight. That's what we're lacking. We're hearing pundits talk in euphemisms. Barack Obama was the master of it, Bill Clinton as well. But we never followed through to see what was the outcome. Was it, as they said, should we now have more faith in them because they delivered, or was it completely different? This is one you won't forget, I promise you. Also, someone took the time to go around to some homeless people. None of the homeless people knew each other. And they showed them tweets being written about them that were posted on the internet, just everyday tweets. And this is listening to the homeless person read the tweet. This is really heart-wrenching. It's bad enough to be poor and homeless, but then to realize how much people despise you is another insult. Well, I'm going to do something about this. I'm going to track down these people, if we can, and I'm bringing in some special people who have the capacity to track down people who listed things anonymously. I like to expose these people, and I want them to hear from people that I'm interviewing. I'm going to go out in July. I'm going to be all across the United States talking with the new homeless to show what it's really like to be homeless. And then how do you feel talking down and badly about people when you're not in their shoes? You have no idea how they suffer. Also from Lee Camp. Lee's a little loud and bombastic, but he hits the nail on this one about the rogue military. Are you aware that we're dropping 121 bombs every single 24 hours somewhere in the world, and yet we have no declared wars? How's that possible? How's it imaginable? And we've been doing this for decades? Who knew? Well, we're going to play this. I think you'll find this of interest. And how religion turned American politics against science. So these are the commentaries that you're going to be hearing today. And you hear them all. Plus, you'll have a chance to call in. Our talkback number is 888-874-4888. And tomorrow, I'll be sharing with you our latest in-depth original investigative reporting. And this is about science-based medicine, energy medicine. Science-based medicine says energy medicine doesn't exist. It's all a myth. It's quackery, fraud. Really? Okay. If you say so, you must be right. After all, you're the ones who were selected by Wikipedia, or you selected Wikipedia or some mutual combination to be the final arbiters of everything truthful. So I guess we can just walk on by, nothing to see here. Oh, wait. Maybe some little thing that you overlooked. Yeah, tomorrow we're going to open up the door and you're going to see a tsunami of truth on something that you never looked into. We have. All based upon peer-reviewed literature. All based upon PubMed. So why don't you do this? Why don't today you inform everyone on your list you got to listen tomorrow at noon, or put it on your download to the archives, because this is going to be one of those real important shows. Let me just give you a couple numbers, because not everybody can listen live, but everybody can download a show at their convenience. Our listen live number is 424-203-8046, 424-203-8046. But down in the archives, you can listen 701-719-9976, 701-719-9976. From Erasmus University Medical Center in the Netherlands, eating a vegetarian diet, or primarily a plant-based diet associated with a variety of health benefits. But simply being vegetarian is not enough to reap those benefits. The quality of the food matters. You've heard me mention many times that you can be an unhealthy vegan or healthy vegan. You could eat bread all day, and that could be a vegan, but wouldn't be healthy. Eating living foods high up on the energy scale, that's what you want, a variety of foods and flavors and colors. Well, according to the latest evidence, eating, quote, eating more plant protein, less animal-derived protein, associated with a lower risk of coronary heart disease. Who says? Well, this study of 6,000 people in the Netherlands, that's who says, they found that, quote, those who ate more plant proteins, where do I get your plant proteins? I thought if you didn't suck on a hot dog every day, you'd die of, you know, of protein malnutrition. No. That rice, the beans, the sweet potato, all those have proteins. All of them have amino acids. All of them have all eight essential amino acids. And that, according to this quote, lowers the risk of developing coronary artery disease. And for a median period of 13 years. So it means in lay language, if you eat a plant-based diet, a healthy plant-based diet, you're less likely to have a coronary heart attack for the next 13 years. Also, quote, eating more plant protein, less animal plant, is associated with less plaque in the arteries. That's a study of 4,500 Brazilian adults that find that those who regularly consume more plant-based protein were 60%, that's 60% less likely than those consuming more animal proteins to show evidence of plaque in the arteries. And why is that important? Well, the plaque is mainly calcium. And that calcium buildup then makes it very hard for the blood to flow through, and therefore forcing your blood pressure up. And when there's a little piece of plaque break, that then clogs your artery. You have an ischemic episode or coronary episode, and either a stroke or heart attack. Also, it's less likely you're going to have heart disease and diabetes. Among South Asians living in the United States, people following a vegetarian plant-based diet have lower numbers of risk factors for diabetes, lower body fat, smaller waist circumference, lower amounts of abdominal fat, lower cholesterol, and lower blood sugar compared to people in the same demographic group who ate meat. And also, eating healthful plant-based foods associated with less weight gain. They looked at 125,000 adults over a four-year period. Guess what? Those on a plant-based diet, rich in high-quality plant-based foods, whole grains, fruits, vegetables, and nuts, were less likely to be overweight. Oh, and finally, not that this is important, well, there's a little tiny asterisk at the end, but a study of 30,000 U.S. adults showed high evidence that a higher quality diet helps you live longer and suggests that the quality of plant-based foods in the diet is more important than the quality of animal-based foods and allows you to live a longer life and have a lower risk of death. So that's pretty good. Now, a lot of people are lonely for different reasons. And Copenhagen University Hospital did a study. And here's what they found. They found that loneliness is bad for the heart, and it's a strong predictor of premature death. That's according to the European Euro Heart Care 2018, the European Society of Cardiology's annual conference. The study found that feeling lonely was a stronger predictor of poor outcomes than living alone in both men and women. Quote, loneliness is more common today than ever before, and more people live alone. Previous research has shown that loneliness and social isolation are linked with coronary heart disease and stroke. But this has not been investigated in patients with different types of cardiovascular disease. This study looked at 13,463 patients with ischemic heart disease and arrhythmias, heart failure and heart valve disease, and they found that add in loneliness, and boy, does your chance of dying go up. So, feeling lonely gives you a poor outcome in all patients, regardless of the type of disease and whether you're male or female or what your age is. So if you're lonely and you're younger, you're lonely and you're middle-aged, you're lonely and older, all of it increases the risk of premature death. Quote, loneliness is a strong predictor of premature death, worse mental health, and lower quality of life in patients with cardiovascular disease. So then the question is this. What do we do about it? Social media is not the answer. It is part of the problem. A sedentary lifestyle, sitting at home, recusing ourselves from our social responsibilities of getting out and networking. And it's certainly understandable because in our society we are so youth-oriented that once you hit a certain age, you're not expected to go dancing or discoing, or you're not expected to do certain things because you're a certain age. Who says why? That's just foolish. And then you get into the relationships. One of my closest relationships, just to give an example, wonderful friendship till we got married. Then suddenly all that friendship with the other single men stopped. Why? Because the relationship consumed all the time. To me, that's not a healthy relationship. You know, if you're in a relationship where someone is jealous of other people who've been in your life, you're in the wrong relationship. Jealousy, envy, need, clawing, it's not going to end well. But that's the way most people have it. And then you see all these people end up in divorce or separation or widowship, and then one day they wake up and they got to start all over again. Where do you start? Bars? That's not a good place. Nightclubs? That's not a good place. These networking places where everybody lies about everything all the time, that's not a good place. How would you suggest? I have my own ideas, but I'd like to hear from you. So our talk back question is this. What advice could you give people who are suffering from loneliness, doesn't matter the age, so that they don't end up with making bad choices from their loneliness. What is your advice? I'd like to see your input on that. The other day I mentioned how good mangoes were to help overcome constipation. Well, according to a new study from the University of California, Davis, mangoes help improve cardiovascular and gut health in women. A new study conducted at the university found that 2 cups of mango a day had beneficial effects on systolic blood pressure. That's great. And if you were postmenopausal woman, it really helped you relax your blood vessels in as little as 2 hours after taking the mango. That's terrific. Quote, this is the first study to demonstrate positive vascular effects of mango intake in humans. Okay. Well, there are a whole lot of people in the islands who have been doing this for centuries who could tell you that mangoes are part of every single day's life. One of the people I work with is from Cuba, born in Cuba. His family still lives in Cuba. And one of the benefits of when I'm at home, I cook for the crew, the people who take care of the animals. I have most of you are aware of this, I have animal rescue. I rescue animals that otherwise would be killed and or sold for meat, and give them a home, get them healthy, get them happy, and then find them a permanent place to live where they can be happy. If they can be let back out in the wild, great, but sometimes they can't, so you find them the best possible sanctuary. Anyhow, I feed them terrific. Oh my goodness, if you saw what I do every morning and how I feed them, I'll just give you an example. And I have a photograph. I put them up on Friday, I think, Thursday last week. I wanted to show people the oldest, at least that I'm aware of, the oldest living ring-tailed lemur in the world. Now, normally they'll live between 15 to 17 years. This is 32 years old. Some of you will remember this. Some of you who came to the retreats back in 1989, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95, in Tioga, Texas, the Healing Springs Ranch. Remember, there was a whole family of ring-tailed lemurs that were outside, and they'd be outside all day playing, and people would sit there and hand-feed them grapes, and we had bowls of fruit. They never bit anyone. They were wonderful. That female, from then, is alive today, and she's the oldest living, by almost 200 years in human life. And I start off with the freshest fruit, and from the property, mangoes, lychee, star fruit, persimmons, melons, watermelon, cantaloupe, honeydew, crenshaw, apples, 2 different types of cherries, and then a protein shake, the one I drank myself, and the one that all of you drank when you were down at the retreats. I have at least 42 to 50 different fruits and vegetables that have been dehydrated, so they're more nutritionally powerful than coconut oil, vegan flaxseed oil from flax seeds, nut butters like almond butter or walnut butter put in and blended in. And then always try to get really good high-quality probiotic, and then the protein, generally from split pea or brown rice. And the way I make it, because I use several exotic powders that I buy from around the world, they're very dark fruits, so it looks like mud. In fact, people say that's Gary having his mud breakfast, but that's what I liquefy and give to the animals every morning. And so I'm flooding their body with healing nutrients. And then throughout the day, they get snacks. And the snacks are always something like a red sweet bell pepper. They'll get, some of them like onions, some don't, piece of pineapple, mango. And she can eat a whole mango. And by the way, so she's one example, but all the other creatures are also equally healthy, including the dogs. And every morning, by the way, I put a whole syringe of color oil right down the throats of the dogs. You got to do that if you want them to live a longer life. and give them brown rice and quinoa and millet with vegetables and olive oil. Then suddenly you see that they don't have the ticks, they don't have the fleas, they don't have the bad breath. Brush your teeth. Remember, you got to brush your dog's teeth every morning and make sure that they don't have any bacteria in there, and give them probiotics also. Clean drinking water. Water is very important, filtered and clean. Most people don't realize how important water is. There's 72% of your body's weight's water, but people don't think about the quality of the water that goes in. You should. Anyhow, you'll see photographs. And remember I said that back when the hurricane came that I had major damage, the largest amount of damage of any home in Florida from my insurance company. And because I have more trees, I planted, personally planted over 5,000 palm trees and thousands of bougainvillea and other types of plants. It's like a little paradise. It's my hobby. It's what I do to relax my brain. And always planting. And a lot of it was destroyed. But the big trees, including 11,000-pound Bismarck, fallen down. They all said, you got to take it out. Charging $1,000, $1,500 to cut them all up. A rosewood tree is dead. It's out of the ground. 9 other trees, big ones. Canary date palms, about 8,000 pounds. They're going to die within a day or two. Their root balls hole to the ground. I said, no, I'm not going to take any. Well, then you're just going to have a bunch of dead tree here. No, I'm not. Yeah, you are. No, I'm not. I'm not. Maybe you can't heal it. I will. That's not possible. They look at me like I was an idiot. Every one of those trees are alive and well. I got a crane. You actually see the crane. It took me 6 months to finally find a crane operator. Found it by just going up to a guy who was working on a building and say, can I hire you for a few hours? I just need you for 3 or 4 hours. Charge me what you want. Charged me $1,500. Came over. I couldn't get anything big enough that we could lift 11,000 pounds. Well, we lifted it up, put it in the ground, and I'm telling you, the tree is doing great. It was out of the ground with its root ball out of the ground for 7 months. Now, think of this. How do you keep a tree alive when its entire source of nutrition, its root system, has been traumatized and it's out of the ground? All those trees you'll see in the pictures, you'll see them on the ground, and you'll see them healthy and alive. And yet there are those people who don't believe in... No, I won't even go into that. See for yourself, all right? They say it can't be done. The pictures show it can. An animal can't live more than 16 years. There's 32 years. Now explain it. You can't. They can't. They'll never be able to explain it. But you can see it for yourself. In fact, you know what I'm going to do? There's always these people who don't believe that anything is possible because they haven't created it. If I don't create it, it can't exist. No, that's narcissism. We should always be humble in what we don't know and always open to what we can. I'm going to play a little clip from a person, just an average person, attended our last retreat as a fundraiser for this station. That's why 1,000 of you got your premiums, because that money went for those premiums. And we're happy to do that. But here's one of the results.
Hi, this is Imani. I'm from New York, from the Bronx. I just finished a week here at Gary's retreat. I came here with systemic candida. I had rashes all over my body, the worst on my foot. I had ulcers. It was just very bad. I couldn't walk. I had to take cabs back and forth to work every day. A lot of money was spent just trying to figure out how I was going to travel places. And luckily, my family has been listening to Gary for years. I'm a Gary baby. I've never been vaccinated. I've grown up vegan, but along the way, you know, you start listening to your peers. You start not doing what you know you're supposed to do, which made me very sick. So, but I do have some knowledge. So I was able to get rid of the ulcers with some colloidal silver and some mustard seed oil. But for some reason, I feel like because of the environment of New York, I just couldn't kick it completely. It still pained me to put regular shoes on. Couldn't wear sneakers, couldn't wear any type of other shoes. And just being here 1 week, this environment, the energy, the spirituality of it, my skin was a whole nother color. I'm like a light brown complexion. My foot was like a dark brown, almost black. And now the color of my skin has completely returned. I'm back to my normal color, and I think that it's actually finally died down. I've had candida for almost a year now, and I feel like this week has kind of wrapped it up. It's the last of it. So my skin has really restored itself just being here. So I'm very grateful.
Okay. May not seem like a lot, but for a year she had candida, and the candida was so bad that it discolored her foot. But also, you can't have just candida in one place. You're going to have it a lot of different places. It's what gives your bad breath smell, because that yeast is coming up through every time you breathe and coming out your mouth, and your whole body stinks, and it's really bad. And it was all healed in 1 week. So, just a little thing. And every day this week, I'm just going to play another example, but we're going to get more extreme in how the people reverse situations as the week goes on. Some you won't even believe, but actually happened, and we filmed it. And I'm going to post the video of something that, I'm not going to tell you what happened, but it was something no one expected, no one knew was coming. And on a Friday, the last day people were there, I decided to try something. And it worked. And they've never done anything like this in their life. And everyone listening will say, that's not possible, and you're absolutely right. It's not. But they did it. We filmed it, and all the people were there saw it. So we did it. So it is possible. So some fun things coming at you. And by the way, from Soroka University Medical Center in Israel, sufferers of chronic pain have been faced with a perilous decision, risk a crippling addiction to opiates, or find a way to live with the pain. A new clinical study is focused on medical cannabis as an alternative to opiates, and the results are turning very positive as a safe, plant-based option for easing pain. This is a new study published in the European Journal of Internal Medicine, and it represents hope for hundreds of millions of sufferers of chronic pain. And researchers at the Cannabis Clinical Research Institute and Soroka University Medical Center and Ben Gurion University in Israel found that the medical cannabis can significantly reduce chronic pain without adverse effects, particularly among adults. So I think that's very important, and we should be looking at that in the United States as well. And just on that same theme, but a different part of it, hemp shows potential for treating ovarian cancer. This is from Sullivan University College of Pharmacy. Hemp, one of the oldest plants in continuous use by humans, has been utilized for over 8,000 years. Oh, wow. That's not possible. Why is it not possible? Because I just heard a Republican legislator, say that the planet is only 6,000 years old. Okay, so everything older than 6,000 years couldn't have existed. That's correct. My God, we actually have people in the office who believe this. In any case, try 4,300,000,000 years. But 8,000 years, they've been using hemp, rope, paper, clothing, shoes. Now new research demonstrates that this ancient plant may also prove to be a useful ally in the life and or death battle against some of the most lethal forms of cancer, including ovarian cancer. And they found that it is powerful in healing. And so I'm going to bring on some experts who have deep backgrounds in healing using hemp and or cannabis on an upcoming program. That's the latest on health and nutrition. Now we're halfway through our program. And I want to have you listen to some homeless people, just selected at random, and they were shown what people around them were posting about them. Now, these people didn't know each other. This was just on a street. And I believe it was in San Francisco. Listen, it's short. It's only a minute and a half long.
I hate the homeless. I don't feel sorry for you. If you want change, let me throw it at you as hard as I can.
At your dirty face.
I hate when it gets cold out because then all the homeless people get on the bus.
I wonder if homeless people go to heaven.
Maybe if homeless people took care of themselves, looked pretty, we would want to help them. But I don't help yellow teeth. Well.
Never understand why homeless people smell of piss when you can literally piss anywhere.
I was enjoying a latte when I saw a hobo girl across the street. I almost vomited. Get back on your side of the bridge. No one likes you.
I hate seeing homeless people standing in the cold, shivering. Be glad when the light turns green. Well, that'll make it go away, won't it?
If homeless is where the heart is, then are homeless people heartless?
Hmm. Wow.
Far from it.
That's what we think. What kind of heartless person would say that? Well, we're going to do something about it. It's going to be my next big project. Starting within the next 4 weeks, I'll be taking on the plight of the homeless. I'm going to at least 15 cities, plus in the suburbs. I'm going to hit this from every possible angle, not just the people on the streets. I'm going to give them their voice. In fact, I'm going to give probably 1,000 to 2,000 people a voice and stream that so that people can hear the voice and look at the circumstances and understand how they got homeless. But more importantly, I'm going to look at the underlying causes of it. Loss of equality, loss of care, loss of concern. I'm going to get in the face of the politicians who say it should be a crime to be poor and to reintroduce debtors' prisons. I'm going to show you debtors' prisons. I'm going to go into those debtors' prisons. I'm going to show you the private prison system. I'm going to show you the politicians like the Clintons that love the private prison system. I'm going to show you everything. It's going to be at least what we can do to bring their story so we can help them. It's the least we can do. I'll also be encouraging people to help a homeless person. I'll explain how. And if we all took the time and energy to try to help a person who's homeless, we wouldn't have any homeless people. But it means that we have to make it a priority. So we will. And also, for those of you who want to join me for different parts of this, some of you live on the West Coast, may want to be there when I'm there, down in Washington, Atlanta, other places. I'll let you know, because I'm going to be traveling, I'm going to outfit a RV so I can film and broadcast and do everything I need to do from a traveling location. If you want to be a part of this, just go to prnstudio@gmail.com, prnstudio@gmail.com, and just put down a little bit about yourself, why you want to join in, and what's your background. Okay? I'll be selecting people from that. Now, I'm going to play two things. First, I want to play this little scene from one of the best-written films, Network. But there's also, I had never seen this film before. I was writing yesterday the commentary I'm going to give you tomorrow. And it's going to take about a half hour or longer. And then I'm going to post it. And I gave myself a break and I went in and I turned on Turner Classics. And there was, I think it was View from the Terrace with Paul Newman and Joanne Woodward. What a combination. He is one of the most singly charismatic actors in Hollywood. But he was also a social activist, big time. And he really put it out there all through his entire career. But here's what was important about what I saw. And the screenplay in parts was absolutely brilliant. This took place back in the beginning to the mid-1950s. and it was about a couple, I'm guessing around 35 to 40 years of age. And he, the Paul Newman character, had worked at this Wall Street investment firm. And he was absolutely determined to succeed. And finally, they decide to make him a partner, a full partner. And what the man was saying about why he was being made a partner included the fact that he would frequently work till 4 in the morning, that he gave up holidays to go on trips to find research about companies they were going to buy, merge with, that he put everything in his life behind his career, the company. And his wife, the other partners didn't know, but his wife had been cheating on him. And the boss of the company said, here, you have to stay in a marriage, even if someone's cheated you, because staying based upon the contract is what's important. So here he's saying, in effect, that if you don't have a love-filled marriage, if you've had no time for your children, your spouse, yourself, then you deserve to be up in this corporate hierarchy, in this revered place. But in the process, you've had to give up everything up to that point in your life, some of the best years of your life, as a careerist. Quite simply, it was one of the most insightful, honest discussions about what you sacrifice as a careerist I've ever heard in my life. For that alone, for that 1 3-minute speech, I would watch the film. But it's a morality play, and he accepts it and then turns in a report that will destroy his career, and he resigns simultaneously. He's a partner, and 1 minute later after he gives his speech, and his speech about what he had to sacrifice in order to get successful, in order to be a partner. Everything that was important in his life, watching his children grow, having quality time to sit and read a book, to go to the beach, to walk with his wife around Central Park, everything that was important he had to sacrifice. Now, how close is that till today? When I counsel people who are highly successful, who spend 20 years on Wall Street and don't have a friend, can't tell you that the last time they took a vacation, they go to bed late at night with their laptop open doing work, and they get up first thing in the morning and they're ready to go again, all for the company because of how important that career, making money and being successful, is. They succeed at the same time they fail at life. Succeeding at a career and failing at life. I can show you doctors, lawyers, engineers, architects, accountants. Not a good trade-off. Business people working 80 hours a week. So it's well worth seeing. That leads us in to what he's saying here in Network. And I could have sworn if I didn't see who wrote the screenplay that Paddy Chayefsky could have written that Paul Newman 1950s film as well as he did the one Network. Here's just a snippet of this.
I don't have to tell you things are bad. Everybody knows things are bad. It's a depression. Everybody's out of work or scared of losing their job. The dollar buys a nickel's worth. Banks are going bust. Shopkeepers keep a gun under the counter. Punks are running wild in the street, and there's nobody anywhere who seems to know what to do, and there's no end to it. We know the air is unfit to breathe, and our food is unfit to eat. We sit watching our TVs while some local newscaster tells us that today we had 15 homicides and 63 violent crimes, as if that's the way it's supposed to be. We know things are bad, worse than bad. They're crazy. It's like everything everywhere is going crazy, so we don't go out anymore. We sit in the house, and slowly the world we're living in is getting smaller, and all we say is, please, at least leave us alone in our living rooms. Let me have my toaster and my TV and my steel-belted radios, and I won't say anything. Just leave us alone. Well, I'm not going to leave you alone. I want you to get mad. I don't want you to protest. I don't want you to ride. I don't want you to write to your congressman because I wouldn't know what to tell you to write. I don't know what to do about the depression and the inflation and the Russians and the crime in the street. All I know is that first, you've got to get mad. You've got to say, I'm a human being. God damn it. My life has value. So, I want you to get up now. I want all of you to get up out of your chairs. I want you to get up right now and go to the window, open it, and stick your head out and yell, I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore! I want you to get up right now. Get up, go to your windows, open them, and stick your head out and yell, I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore. Things have got to change.
How many stations does this go out?
You've got to get mad.
67. I know it goes to Louisville and Atlanta.
We're not going to take this anymore. Then we'll figure out what to do about the depression and the inflation and the oil crisis. But first, get up out of your chairs, open the window, stick your head out and yell, and say, I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take this anymore.
Here's the problem. You don't hear Americans sticking their head out of the window of a car or a building where they work or their home and saying, I'm mad as hell, not going to take any more. The people have been dumbed down. They've been emotionally anesthetized. They have been put into this deep sleep of distraction. Bread and circuses. Think of all the poor, if they join together. Think of all the people that do all the work who are the living working poor. What if they went on strike, refused to sell you hamburgers, refused to do the linens in the hotels? It would bring America to a standstill, so at least the important issues could be examined. We're not there yet. We're not going to have any change on the climate. We're not going to have any change in our health care system with all these people sick and dying and can't afford their health care. We're not yet evolved enough to accept universal health care. We're not yet evolved enough to stop dropping over 121 bombs every 24 hours in undeclared wars. We're not yet evolved enough to stop using the very people who create the inequality, their credit cards, to buy stuff we don't need frequently. And what we frequently buy causes our problems, including our hot dogs and hamburgers and houses we don't need. We're not going to do anything whatsoever about taking money out of campaigning to stop the corruptions, to challenge the oligarchs. You see, of all the things that are problematic, we're not in enough pain to do anything about them. And the pain we do have is as if all of the people are on non-opiates. Their pain has been taken away by distraction, so distraction becomes the ultimate medication. But then we look at this, an ex-Marine. He wants to get our attention back. And just like this commentator, they share something in common. Listen to him.
How is it possible that anybody with any kind of sanity would consider the United States or Britain or the West in general to be in any kind of position to be punishing anyone for any illegalities? If we want to take a look at Iraq, there is at least 1 million, probably even close to 2 million dead. We invaded that country, destroyed it, created millions of orphans, millions of refugees, and never even so much as apologized for that. Let's go back to Vietnam, where we dropped 20 million bombs, more than all of World War II combined. We have destroyed so many countries. We have tortured and killed and maimed and raped around this planet. Who in the hell in their right mind would consider the United States or the West in general to be in any position to punish anybody? Never mind the obvious facts that this is a false flag attack. Well, we don't operate under international law. What we have is the color of law, the law of the jungle, in which the rich and the powerful basically determine what goes and what doesn't go. Iraq is a perfect example of that. Why isn't Tony Blair and George Bush rotting away in a prison cell for the rest of their lives? Because the law is not being applied. These are war criminals and they should be in prison for the rest of their lives, if not executed, if their own rules were adhered to for their own crimes. Well, the Greater Israel Project is all about destabilizing surrounding nations, ultimately in pursuit of this dream of Greater Israel from the Euphrates down to the Nile, all the way over to the Eastern Mediterranean. This is the dream of these psychopaths, and so destabilizing governments, creating sectarian strife, is all part of that menu and all part of the design to create Greater Israel. So that goes, that's self-evident. But I have to go back to what this gentleman is saying in Washington, D.C. about America not wanting to get involved, or Obama not getting involved. What are you talking about? We have been arming people directly who are Al-Qaeda. Al-Nusra Front is Al-Qaeda. These people are psychopaths to the worst order. They're conducting suicide attacks. They're gassing people. We know Carla Del Ponte said in May that it was the so-called rebels in Syria that were using sarin gas, not the Bashar al-Assad regime. No, it was not. We know that the United States president is arming people who are on the U.S. terrorist list. He should be convicted of aiding and abetting, giving material support to a terrorist organization. But then again, you know what? We, the West, the United States in particular, Israel and Britain, are the biggest terrorists on the planet. So our little junior partners in Al-Qaeda, which is nothing more than a CIA database, thus the name Al-Qaeda, this is nothing more than a group of terrorists working together, each playing one different role, but all of them working together for the same goal, which is to maintain this hideous and sick and twisted, unjust world that we have, which is a perpetual state of war. Always one illusion, one boogeyman after another. But the fact is, Obama is nothing more than a puppet war criminal, just like his predecessor and every other U.S. president before him. So please don't tell people out there that the U.S. is not involved. It's directly involved, and it is arming people who are absolute psychopaths. The United States is in a perpetual state of war because the bankers control the politicians, and they read the script as given to them by the banksters, and they make huge amounts of money off of this. What this gentleman is saying about the United States not wanting war, not wanting to get involved, is like Iraq 2.0. It's a repeat of the same rubbish that was said. Oh, we don't want war. War is a last resort. That's absolutely untrue. It's a lie. Those that are in government are nothing more than prostitutes who are carrying out the orders of those who are in charge of them, and those that are in charge want another war. And part of that is what we discussed earlier, the Greater Israel Project, to destabilize any Arab regime which might have any kind of autonomy and self-determination. Any regime in the Arab world.
Okay. He's telling the truth. The truth that you will not hear on any mainstream media, and nor on most alternative media. Now we're going to finish up with Lee Camp, because he's adding something to that. Did you know that we were dropping 121 bombs every 24 hours with no declaration of war? The average person is completely clueless on this. Even well-intuned liberals don't always know this. Here's what Lee has to say on it.
By the end of this segment, someone will be bombed. I don't mean by me. That'd be a bit aggressive for a comedy show, I feel like. No, I mean by the U.S. military, which is odd because we're technically at war with, let me see, zero countries, I think. So that should mean zero bombings, right? You've confused our world with some sort of rational, cogent world in which our military-industrial complex is under control, and the music industry is based on merit and talent, and we're preparing and dealing with climate change like adults, rather than burying our heads in the sand while trying to convince ourselves that the sand around our head isn't getting really, really hot. And Legos have gently rounded edges on the sides so that when you step on them barefoot, it doesn't feel like an armor-piercing bullet straight to your scrotum. You're thinking of a rational world. We don't live there. No, we don't. Instead, we live in a world where the Pentagon is completely out of... A few weeks ago, I talked on this show about the $21 trillion, trillion with a T, that has gone unaccounted for at the Pentagon. But I didn't get into the number of bombs that ridiculous amount of money buys you. According to Consortium News, President Bush's military dropped 70,000 bombs on five countries. But of that outrageous number, it was really just 57 of those bombs that really upset the international community. Because there were 57 strikes in Pakistan, Somalia, and Yemen, countries the U.S. was not at war with and didn't even have ongoing conflicts within. And the world was kind of horrified. There was a lot of talk that went something like this. Wait a second. We're bombing in countries outside of war zones? Is it possible that's a slippery slope ending in us just bombing all the time? Nah. Whichever president follows Bush will be a normal adult person with a functional brainstem of some sort and will therefore stop this madness. No, we were so cute and naive back then, weren't we? We were like a little kitten waking up. Like, under President Obama, there were 563 strikes, largely by drones, that targeted Pakistan, Somalia, and Yemen. Despite the fact that bombing outside of a war zone is a horrific violation of international law and global norms, and we're targeting people for pre-crimes, all right? This guy in the hills of Afghanistan looks kind of like he might do something we don't like one day. Let's take out his whole family and his home and his chickens. Don't forget his chickens, because he can never be too safe. What if his chickens decide to avenge his death, you know? Despite all of that, there was basically a media blackout while Obama was president. You could count on one hand the number of mainstream media reports on Obama's extracurricular bombing campaigns. And even when they did mention it, the underlying sentiment was, yeah, but look at how suave he is, right? Look at how suave he looks while he's okaying endless destruction. He's Steve McQueen over here with trillions of dollars of death under his coat. Not cool, Steve McQueen. And don't believe the hype that our advanced weaponry only hits bad guys. According to the CIA's own documents, the people on the kill list who were targeted for death by drone accounted for only 2% of the deaths caused by drone strikes. 2%. Really, Pentagon? Really? You got a 2 on the test? A 2. A 2? You get 5 points for spelling your name right, Pentagon. Huh? I mean, If we graded our military the same way we grade a fifth grader, he'd be the kid that the teacher, like, takes pity on and has him empty the trash cans for extra credit, and he still accidentally lights the bulletin board on fire somehow just by emptying the trash. But that 70,000 bombs dropped by Bush, it was child's play. Obama dropped 100,000 bombs in 7 countries. He outbombed Bush by 30,000 bombs and 2 countries. Man, that's impressive. That puts him in a very elite group of Nobel Peace Prize winners. Nobel Peace Prize winners who have killed that many innocent civilians. The reunions are mainly just him and Kissinger, you know, wearing little hand-drawn name tags. They say, Henry. And you're just sitting there munching on deviled eggs. And every once in a while, I think they'll let Bob Dylan join them, but Dylan hardly killed any people. But despite all of that, Donald Trump's administration is topping everyone, blowing them out of the water. He has basically taken the gloves off the military. So they're now just dropping bombs every time they think about maybe dropping bombs. And it's not necessarily because Trump loves bombing. He might, but I don't know if he does. It's mainly, I think, because A, he does not like to read things. B, he is basically incapable of reading things that aren't about him. And C, he'd rather the Pentagon just do whatever they want without asking him, rather than make him read things. So the end result is a military that's behaving like Lil Wayne crossed with Conor McGregor, all right? You look away for 2 seconds, and you look back, and you're like, what the f*** did you just do? I was gone for 2 seconds. Jesus, man. Now we gotta rebuild Somalia. Journalist David DeGraw, which he's where I've gotten a lot of this information, he's also found that the Pentagon's own numbers show during George W. Bush's 8 years, he averaged 24 bombs dropped per day, which is 8,750 per year. Over the course of Obama's time in office, his military dropped 34 bombs per day, 12,500 per year. And in Trump's first year in office, he averaged 121 bombs dropped a day for an average annual total of 44,096. Five bombs.
All connected together. When was the last time you heard a protest against all of the countries that we have invaded and destroyed and are continuing to destroy with 121 bombs a day? Not a peep. Medea Benjamin, yes, and Code Pink, but from the American public, the American media, not a word. It's just not important to them. But it's still important to those people who are getting their communities destroyed. We're going to end today with a quick answer from Ronald.
Hello.
Hi.
Yes.
Your answer on loneliness.
Yes, I feel that probably the best way to meet people is simply people that we happen to meet at random, people we come into physical contact with, whether when we go out, whether it's shopping or we're going to the library or any physical interaction.
Okay, but a lot of people don't go out, and a lot of people, even when they're out, they don't want to connect with people because they're still coming from fear of being rejected. Why not do this? Why not put an ad out that you're going to have a social for people who are lonely, who would just like an opportunity to come and spend an evening together with a group of people, select a restaurant, maybe a vegan restaurant, and plan on eating and socializing and seeing if you can begin to come out of the shell and to reconnect at a level that's important to you with other people who have something in common, just being honest about it.
That seems like a good idea, too.
Okay. Thank you. We're out of time. I appreciate you calling in, Roland.
Okay. Bye.
I'm Gary Null. We're out of time. We're always here to empower people. Got a whole lot to empower you with tomorrow. Have a nice day.